So we also mentioned that while we started discussing the quadratic forms, okay? So if you have quadratic forms like this, an example in here, so you can write such a quadratic form in this fashion. Therefore, if you say that, well, if you somehow diagonalize this term, okay, if you just, for example, do some operations, and then if you can replace this A matrix in here by some forms of the D matrix, which is basically the diagonal matrix, therefore you can get rid of this cross products in here. So what you can do is basically in such a case, you can convert your problem, okay, to this format, okay? So which is basically, if you say that, well, again, for the diagonalization, if you select the normalized eigenvectors of your A matrix, and then you construct a Q matrix for yourself and Q transpose for yourself, then what you can do is basically, you can write a quadratic forms in terms of the canonical form, in which you get rid of the, for example, the cross products, like, you know, x1, x2, x2, x3, or x1, xn, etc. You only retain x1 square, x2 square, and xn square, okay? Therefore, it's going to be beneficial for you to evaluate the minima or the maxima of the function, okay? So yesterday, we came up to here, I guess, okay? So let's solve an example, start from here. So we can say that, well, if you have a function which involves, like, you know, n parameters, x1, x2, and xn, and then if you say, for example, let's work in, for first of all, let's work in one dimensions, and if you say that f of x is equal to this stuff in here, which comes from the Taylor series expansion, okay, then you can say that, well, if you put this term, this constant term on the left-hand side, and then if you want to evaluate, for example, this thing, this difference, and then if you are evaluating a minima or maxima problem, okay, minima or maxima of a function occurs where the first derivative is basically zero. You know this very well from the high school. And then the second part, the remaining part in here is basically a quadratic form, okay? So what you have in here is basically a quadratic form. You have something like x squared, x minus a squared, a difference square, and then a constant in front. Therefore, if you want to evaluate, if you want to assess if this point is basically a minimum point or maximum point or just a saddle point, then you can say that, well, I need to check the second derivative, okay? So if the second derivative is positive, which means that you have a curvature plus, okay? The second derivative is an indicator of the curvature. So you have the first derivative equal to zero, and as well as the second derivative of the function is equal to positive. Then if this is positive, then you are at a minimum value of a function. But if your function, for example, reaches a maximum value, the first derivative is zero, and then the second derivative, which is if you draw a parabola, which is tangent to this stuff in here, is going to be in the, for example, negative direction. So you will have a maximum point in this case. But you say that, well, if the second derivative is zero, you basically have no information. So what about the second, for example, case? So in this case, you have two parameters, x and y parameters. And then if you do a Taylor series expansion, okay, when you do the Taylor series expansion and put the constant term over left-hand side as indicated here, so what you are going to see is basically you have this, for example, x squared, x minus a squared term. You will have y minus b squared term. So, but additionally, again, this right-hand side, whole right-hand side is a quadratic expression, okay, quadratic form. But you also see cross products in here, like, you know, x minus a and y minus b. Therefore, you can say that, well, if you write this, for example, in the matrix format, okay, x transpose times x times a times a, excuse me, and then times x. And in here, you can say that your x vector is basically a column vector, involves entries like x minus a and y minus b, okay? And again, if you do the, for example, the diagonalization, you use the eigen, you have a matrix in here, you use the normalized eigen vectors to obtain the Q matrix, and then you transform your old parameter into a new parameter. And if you do so after this, for example, steps, the diagonalization, so you will be able to express your quadratic form and keeping only x1 square and x2 square. Therefore, what you do is basically you convert a general quadratic form into a canonical form, okay? So what did you achieve by doing so? What did you achieve by doing so is basically you get rid of this, for example, cross products. Okay. So once you get rid of these cross products, then you can basically say that, well, if this function, for example, is making a minima or maxima, well, I can say that, well, for example, I can say that, well, this thing and that thing is basically going to be zero, because when the function reaches a maximum or minimum, the first derivatives in two directions are supposed to be equal to zero. But in order to make a conclusion to say that this is a minimum point or a maximum point, I need to evaluate this quadratic term in here. And well, checking this quadratic term is not easy because of this cross product, because you have x and y. Depending on the value of x and y, it can be a positive sign or it can be a negative sign. Therefore, you cannot derive a decisive conclusion. But if you use the diagonalization and convert your problem to a canonical form, which involves only x1 square and x2 square, therefore, you can say that, well, this term in here is always positive and that term in here is always positive. And then depending on the natures of the eigenvalues, like lambda 1 and lambda 2, you can basically say that, well, if both of them are basically negatives, therefore this stuff in here is going to give you a maximum, because this whole thing is going to be a maximum. But well, if, for example, lambda 1 and lambda 2 are basically positive, this whole thing in here is a positive, therefore you end up with a minimum of a function. And then if you have mixed signs, like, you know, 1 minus 1 plus, therefore, again, you're no decisive conclusion. You say this is a saddle point in which the first derivative vanishes, but there is no conclusion that you can draw about if this is a maximum or minimum of a function, okay? So this is one of the other uses of the diagonalization in the quadratic forms, the canonical variables. So if you want to evaluate the minima or a maxima of a function, this is something that you can do. Any questions until here? Well, if no questions, then if you say, for example, if you have higher dimensional cases, okay, you can basically say that you can do this to the higher dimensions as well, and then you can write the expression in here in this fashion. Well, let's analyze a buckling problem, okay? So in which, in this problem, you have, like, you know, quadratic like terms if you evaluate the, for example, potential. So if you, when you analyze this buckling problem, so when we do the diagonalization to analyze this problem, so we will say that, well, we will be able to find the, for example, the modes of the deflection, okay? So what if this one basically moving forward and if this one moving leftward, etc. So you will have different mode of the motion in here. And then additionally, we will have the critical buckling load, which makes the, for example, the system unstable, okay? So let's begin with the problem. So it's a typical buckling problem for those of you who are studying, for example, steel structures, okay? We have seen this in the steel structures. If you have a pin support in here, as indicated in here, and if this beam is just a monolithic, a one-piece beam, there is no, for example, connections. If you just think this as a rigid beam, and then if you have a pin support, and then if you upload this, therefore you find the first mode of the sine function. You can write the governing equation by taking the moments about this base point, and then it's going to be easy to calculate. But if you have a fixed support in here, so if you have fixed support and if you have the same problem, again a rigid, for example, one, this buckling problem is going to give you a transcendental equation, okay? An equation in the forms of tangent x is equal to x. Therefore, in order to find the buckling shapes, etc., and the critical loads, you need to solve an equation numerically, okay? Tangent x is equal to x. So there are some examples about that one, but this one is statically determinant, okay? So I can write the governing equations for this problem. And then we have pin support, so which makes the problem a determinant problem. Therefore, if you have a load P, and then if you define your z-coordinate like this, and if you have two, for example, springs of stiffnesses K and K, okay? And then if you say that, well, if this moves, for example, rightward a little bit, and then if this moves rightward a little bit, and then if you have a deflected shape like this, okay, you will have a deflected shape like this. So what you do is basically this rigid part is basically moves and reorients itself in this position, okay? And this rigid part bar in here basically reorients itself in this position, and that one is basically that position. So you can basically define some angles like for example, this is alpha, so this is gamma, this is beta, and this is alpha, okay? And then you can write the, for example, the potential of this, the buckling problem, or the basically column, to evaluate the stability. Then you can say that, so as for example, x, y, and z goes to zero, so when, for example, this deflection, that deflection, and deflection of the, for example, the object in here basically reduces to zero, then you can say that you can write the potential energy of the system in terms of this, okay? So what you do has basically, well, you have a force, so these are weightless, for example, these rigid parts. And then if you extend this a little bit, an amount of x, okay? Therefore, you know that the force is equal to k times x. And then when you multiply force with dx and integrate this out, or if you find the change in the, for example, or if you want to evaluate the work, work is basically equal to the change in the potential energy. So you will say that, well, if you integrate force with respect to x, then you obtain the potential energy. Kx integrated is going to give you 1 over 2 kx squared. And similarly, this spring is going to be stretched, and then you will see another potential term arising from here, 1 over 2 ky squared. And then you are going to see that this part in here is going to move down a little bit. So you will see that compared to the initial configuration, okay, so you have this initial configuration. At the secondary configuration, you have stretching and potential energy, stretching and potential energy. But this block in here, or this P in here, block is massless, but P moved down a little bit, okay? Initially, you had zero, for example, potential, but at the end, you obtain a potential of P minus Z, okay? So remember, so it's this something like MGH, okay? Gravitational potential due to the weight. Well, you can think this problem, well, as if you have a block which has the weight of P, or you have a massless block and you apply a force of P, okay? They are the identical problems. So it doesn't matter. Any questions so far? So, well, you can write some relations. For example, you can say that, well, for example, if you have, for example, this stuff in here, if you write the governing equation, so you can say that, well, you can use the Pythagorean theorem, and you can find the values of, for example, this stuff in here. So if you for example think about the terms in here, so what you have in here, remember, so this distance is equal to L, okay, and this distance is equal to x, and then L square minus x square square rooted is going to give you this distance. Similarly, this distance is equal to L, and then this distance is equal to y minus x. Therefore, L square minus x minus y squared square rooted is going to give you that distance. So you find this one, that one, okay? So you find this one, that one, and similarly, you find out this one, okay? And additionally, you have a distance of z in here. Therefore, all of this is going to give you 3L. So what you are saying is basically, if you want to make the problem even complicated, you can say that what if I put a, for example, an elastic beam in here? So when I, for example, deform this a little bit, then this becomes, for example, shrinking or dilating maybe, or stretching, okay, your beam. Well, you can make this problem even more complicated if you put a, for example, a non-constant term, if you have a flexible structure, for example. So your buckling problem is going to be slightly harder. Or you can also make other complications, like you can say, you can put a different, for example, stiffness value in here and another one, okay? So, well, if you have such a geometric relation for a rigid beam, then you can rearrange this. Well, you can say that, well, it doesn't matter if I take, for example, the L square, for example, or the L outside this square root sign. So if you take the L outside of this square root sign, and similarly that one and that one, so you will be able to write this equation in this form. Okay, so you have such a form, okay, and using basically the, again, the binomial expansion that we have described last time, okay, so if your x parameter is small, so it can either be a positive sign or negative sign, but if the absolute value of x is much smaller compared to one, therefore you can use the binomial expansion in this fashion. So Therefore, you can say that, well, you have, for example, you have Z in here, Z is identical, L in here, and L is identical. What you have is basically something like, so if you say 1 plus Y is equal to 1 plus Y to the A is equal to 1 plus A times Y. Therefore, you have something like a Y in here, okay? So you have something like 1 plus Y to the A. Therefore, this is equal to 1 plus A times, which is the power, A times Y itself. Okay, so I'm using the binomial expansion for this case. What I'm doing is basically, I'm converting a problem, a hard problem, a nonlinear problem to a linear problem. Okay, I'm linearizing this problem. So when I do the binomial expansion. Then you can say that you can do the binomial expansion for the second and the third entries as well. Therefore, if you do so, you are going to see that, well, this is going to be equal to 3L. So if you, for example, perform the operations, then what you are going to see, for example, you have something like a Z term, for example, is going to arise from here. And then from here, what you are going to see, for example, a minus x square over L square. But when you multiply this with L, you will see that this becomes something like minus x square over L term with some constant in front and another constant in front and etc. And then after some manipulations, you will see that your Z is going to be related with this stuff in here. Okay. So any questions until here? Then you can say that, well, if you have the, for example, remember the potential function, okay? So in our potential function, we had something like 1 over 2 kx squared. Therefore, this term is basically retained here. So you have 1 over 2 kx squared, okay, 1 over 2 kx squared. And similarly, you have 1 over 2 ky squared. And then 1 over 2 ky squared survives in here. But additionally, we have minus p times z, okay? So, well, you can say that, well, if you take this expression for Z and then put it over here, and then if you multiply with P, okay, what you are going to see after regrouping these terms is basically something like this. So you will see X squared, you will see Y squared, and then you will see the cross product of X and Y, okay, coming from here. Well, this problem now becomes a quadratic form, okay? So therefore, this is why it is beneficial. So when you see, for example, this kind of energy relations, for example, like in Hamiltonian mechanics, in Lagrangian mechanics, you write the kinetic energy, you write the potential energy, you see this type of quadratic forms are basically be important. Therefore, as I told, when you find the minima or maxima of a quadratic form, okay, so you use the diagonalization, but finding the minima and maxima of a potential function basically refers to a stability problem, okay? So when you check the minimum or the maximum value of a basically potential function, so what you do is basically at which point, for example, this reaches a maximum or minimum, so you basically evaluate the stability of a problem. Therefore, you can say that, you can conclude that the diagonalization is also beneficial for the, useful for the evaluating the stability of the problems, okay? So you can also tell this. Well, if you, as I told, this is a quadratic form, okay? So you can basically, if you define a column vector involving entries X and Y, so you can say that, well, you can write this expression here, X transpose times A times X, okay? So therefore you have a quadratic form. And if you, for example, use the matrix in here, and if you find out the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of this problem, so you can basically convert the quadratic problem into a canonical form, okay? Therefore, this will bring you to find out the stability characteristics, okay? So we can say that, well, if, for example, if when you see such a case, we by inspection, we can see that, well, when you set P is equal to zero, if you apply nothing, then what you are going to see is basically you will have something like kx square over 2 and then ky square over 2. And then this term is going to basically die out. And then it's going to give you a minimum and stable configuration, okay? But what if the general case, what if P is arbitrary, then what you are going to do to evaluate the stability of this problem? Well, this is a check because once you have the symbolic entries, okay, finding the eigenvalues can be confusing, okay? please check this one, how to compute this eigenvalues. So you basically find out the determinant of A minus lambda times I identity matrix, and then you carry out the determinant and find the two roots of alpha 1 and alpha 2. And then for this alpha 1 and alpha 2, you can find the corresponding eigen vectors if you want, okay? Therefore, well, I'm skipping these steps, okay? I'm not finding the eigenvectors at this stage because previously I tried to, let me go back to the previous screen, okay? I tried to convince you that, well, after these steps, when you convert your problem, quadratic problem, into canonical forms, you will only see that lambda 1 and lambda 2 is going to arise here, okay? Therefore, I can safely skip calculation of the eigenvectors in this case. You only find out the eigenvalues, and then you can say that in terms of your new, for example, x, for example, parameter and y parameter, you will be able to re-express your result as a canonical form. But if you say that, well, what is the relation between the x and x prime? Okay, new variable, remember, x prime is nothing but q times x. And then for that case, to answer that question, you need to find out what the q is, okay? Therefore, we can say that, well, you have the potential function, which is represented in the canonical form, okay? And then this basically lambda 1 and lambda 2, you plug these numbers, and this is what you see, okay? So when you say that, well, for example, when you assess the stability of this stuff in here, so if you say, for example, if you want to, for example, the minimum value of this one, okay, therefore what you want to investigate is basically if your P, for example, is less than KL over 3, so pay attention to this expression in here. So it tells you, well, you have, for example, P is basically less than KL in here. So you have, for example, load in here. But you also have any questions from chat? Okay, no problem. Elida wrote a message to me, so sorry for the interruption. Well, if you say, for example, you want to find the minima of this, for example, function, okay? So you want to see that the potential energy reaches a minimum, because if your potential energy is too high, if this reaches, remember, imagine that you plot the graph of the potential function. If the potential function reaches a maximum value, or the second derivative of the function is going to be negative, then what you are going to experience is a stability problem. If the potential goes too high, so your system is going to be prone to the distributions, and then it's going to be unstable. But if your potential function is making a minimum function, okay, like in the case of, for example, the tunneling potential of a Schrödinger equation, then what you are going to see is basically, well, if you can achieve the minimum potential, you will achieve a stable system. And in order to achieve, for example, a minimum, for example, potential, you want to see that, well, this quadratic form supposed to be equal to greater than zero. Therefore, you ask for this supposed to be equal to greater than zero, and that's supposed to be greater than equal to zero. Therefore, you can say that the critical one of these ones is basically that thing, okay? So the minimum stable condition for basically P is P to be less than KL over 3. Therefore, if you're loading, if the P of the weight of the block reaches this value, therefore, you will begin experiencing, for example, some negative signs in here. So the, for one of the stuff in here, if you, for example, put a larger and larger number in here, so this becomes negative after some time. Therefore, you obtain a, for example, a saddle point, and then this this causes an instability. But even if you go, for example, above, basically P is equal to KL, therefore you will see that this part is also going to give you a negative sign, and then it's going to be basically a maximum point, and then it's going to be unstable system. Therefore, the most critical one is basically this stuff in here. So such a load is called your critical buckling load, okay, KL over 3. So there is an alternative way, for example, to evaluate this. Well, you can say that, well, if you want, you don't have to work over the quadratic forms. If you don't write the energy equation, but if you write the Newton force balance, okay? So remember, when you have force and integrate the force with respect to space parameter, you find the potential energy. But if you take the potential energy is x derivative or y derivative, you find the summation of forces acting in the x direction and summation of forces acting in the y direction. Therefore, if you take the, for example, if you write such an expression, then what you are doing is basically you are just writing the force balance. So you have the potential function and you take its x derivative, you obtain an equation. You have the potential function, take the y derivative, and then you obtain another equation. Therefore, if you write this problem, for example, in this form, so you can say that you have some xy parameters, and then if you regroup them as like, you know, kl over p, for example, part times xy, therefore, you what you do is basically you keep the, if you multiply everywhere by l, okay, so this generates you a kl problem, this is 2p, this is only p, and then you keep the kl and p involving terms on the right hand side, and then you keep the constant values arising from here on the left hand side, okay. Therefore, if you say that, well, this kl over p is basically a lambda, okay, then for this lambda you can say that you have something like ax is equal to lambda x problem, okay. Therefore, you introduce an eigenvalue problem for the stability of your column, okay. Therefore, you can have some non-trivial solutions for this case, okay. So it's an easy matrix if you just say this is equal to lambda. So what you find out is basically lambda equal to 1 or lambda equal to 3 is going to be your eigenvalues, and corresponding eigenvectors are like, you know, 1, 1 and 1 minus 1, okay. So therefore, well, you will be able to get the, for example, the modes of oscillation. So when you look at this, for example, eigenvectors, what you see is basically the modes of oscillation. Therefore, well, among these two forces, if you said KL over P is equal to lambda 1 or KL over P is equal to, for example, 3, therefore, you will see that the critical value is going to be the lowest one, okay? Therefore, even if this such a, for example, low, for example, load can make your eigenvalue that you calculated in your, for example, problem a negative one, okay, lambda 2 in here, and then this will cause a stability problem. And don't forget, well, what we calculated for the eigenvectors corresponding to lambda equal to 1, this is the eigenvector we have calculated. Corresponding to lambda equal to 3, this is the eigenvector we calculated, 1, 1 and 1 minus 1. Therefore, what you do, for example, okay, what you do in this case is basically, well, you either have, for example, an elongation for x and y, okay, this is the mode of, for example, one of the oscillations. If you load such a thing, so you will see this is one of the possible configurations, okay, this moves rightward and this one moves rightward, therefore 1, 1, or you can have 1 plus 1 minus, okay, it doesn't matter if you put, for example, well, if you keep beta arbitrary, either positive or negative, this means that you either have one, minus 1, 1 or 1 minus 1, okay. Therefore, the possible two modes is basically if you have, for example, this moves rightward or both of them moves leftward, okay. This is one of the possible configurations. And the second configuration is basically one moving in x and one moving in minus y direction, okay, or vice versa, okay. Therefore, what you find where the eigenvectors that you compute in here is going to give you the modes of oscillation. Okay. Any questions until here? Evet arkadaşlar, sormak istediğiniz bir şey var mı buraya kadar? So let's continue. Seems like there is no question. Sorry. So there are some other applications of the diagonalization. So what are these applications? So for example, remember you have a differential equation, okay, an easy equation. So x prime is equal to ax. What is the general solution of this, for example, expression? So you have, for example, dx over dt. You put the x over here, you put the dt over here and integrate both sides. What you obtain is basically ln x is equal to at plus c. And then if you take the exponentials of both sides, e at times e to the c, and e to the c, you can name this e to the c constant as a new constant, just say c. Therefore, the solution is becoming in terms of the simple exponential, okay, when you have the first derivative. And if you write the matrix version of this one, okay, similarly, this matrix, okay, this matrix form has general solution which is written in this form, okay? So you have xt is equal to e to the a, but a in here is basically your matrix in here, okay? And then you have a column vector, okay, a coefficient vector. But until you specify a boundary condition, you won't be able to find out what this c is, okay? But the general solution is basically looks like this. Therefore, well, if I tell you, for example, if you have e to the a times t, okay, you have a matrix in here, and then you want to evaluate this function at every different time step, for example. So imagine that you are making a problem like from zero is equal to from 1 hour and then up to 24 hours. You want to model the diffusion of a, for example, chemical. And then you have a matrix system in here involving so many, for example, parameters, more than one differential equations, like, you know, maybe four or five. Like in the case of, for example, pandemic. So there are so many models which uses four equations simultaneously for the spread of the pandemic, okay? There are ODE models for this one. And then you can say that, well, if this is the case, well, you need to evaluate this at every time step. And if you have a very, very big matrix, this is going to be costly. Well, remember the Taylor series expansion of an exponential. So if you have, for example, e to the x, okay, what is the Taylor series expansion? It is something like 1 plus x plus x squared over 2 factorial plus x cubed over 3 factorial, and etc. Well, if you write the same matrix notation for this one, you no longer have 1 in here, but you have the identity matrix because you will have matrices in here. And then this becomes identity matrix plus at plus a squared t squared over 2 factorial, and so on and so forth. Okay. Well, the answer is basically how to evaluate this. This is a very costly operation to do if you have, for example, if you want to keep so many terms, okay? But if you say that, for example, you have, for example, a cubed and a to the 3 and etc. And at every time step, you need to compute this, okay, up to the order that you specify. But if you select your, for example, a clearly, or if you can make some operations, then you can, if you can diagonalize the A matrix, then you will see that this calculation is going to be easy, okay? So if, for example, A is diagonalizable, then you can say that by multiplying with the Q inverse and then Q matrices from the left and the right hand sides, you will be able to create a diagonal matrix for you. Therefore, you can put, for example, you can multiply the expression from the left hand side by Q, okay? Therefore, you obtain such a thing, and then additionally you multiply, for example, everywhere by the inverse of the Q. Therefore, you can express your A matrix in terms of the diagonal matrix, okay? So then see what happens to A square, okay? So A square is nothing but A multiplied with A, but Q inverse times Q is going to give you identity matrix, and identity matrix times D is going to give you D itself, and then D times D is going to give you D square. And in front you have Q, and then after the D you have Q inverse, okay? Therefore, computing A square is going to be easy, okay? So if you have a huge matrix, okay, you don't want to do, for example, element by element by operation. You diagonalize your matrix, take the square of the diagonal values, and then again multiply with Q and Q inverse, and then you will be able to recover your A square. And similarly, what about the A cube, okay? So you have A multiplied with A square, which you see here. But again, inverse of Q times Q is going to give you identity matrix, and identity matrix times D square is going to give you D square itself. And then D square times D is going to give you D cube. And then you have Q and Q inverse on the left and the right hand side, so on and so forth. Therefore, you can say that, well, you obtain, for example, such a, for example, relation. Well, if you have, for example, A to the K, an arbitrary power, therefore you can say that, well, I don't need to do this, for example, large matrix operations k times. I diagonalize the matrix, take the k power of the diagonal matrix and multiply it with the Q matrix, which involves the either eigenvectors or orthonormal eigenvectors of your A matrix, and then you will be able to evaluate the kth power for this matrix, okay? Thus you can say that, well, for such a case, okay, if you go to the, for example, asymptotically, so what you are going to do? Well, if you want to evaluate an exponential like this, okay, exponential is nothing but as I did. Well, we did the Taylor series expansion in here. So you have 1 plus, for example, 80 plus 80 squared divided by 2 factorial. But you can say that 1 is nothing but the Q matrix multiplied with its inverse identity matrix. So this is going to give you the identity matrix. And instead of 80, you can say that, well, I express my A matrix like this, and then I, instead of putting A in here, I put, for example, Q, D and Q prime and T in here. Okay, you move the T, for example, inside. And then if you have, for example, 80 square over 2, therefore, when you have the 80 square, then 80 square is going to give you Q times Q inverse, and in the between, you will have D square, T square, etc. And then if you regroup these terms, okay, what you are going to see in, for example, in here is something like this. So you will see Q is going to survive in the front, Q inverse is going to survive on the right hand side. But in here, what you will see is basically the Taylor series expansion for the diagonal terms, okay, which means that you have the diagonal, for example, entries. Therefore, since these entries are diagonal, so you only have diagonal elements, no, nothing off diagonal. Therefore, you can do this, convert this to an element or the entry by entry operation. Okay, so you can say that, well, this is nothing but the first expression is the Taylor series expansion involving lambda one. Okay, the first, the diagonal term in here, and lambda 1 and t. And then the second one involves, like, you know, 1 plus lambda 2 t plus 1 over 2 factorial lambda 2 square t square. And similarly, the nth term, the nth entry is basically involving 1 plus lambda n t plus 1 over 2 factorial lambda n square and t square. Okay, so, well, if you realize this is nothing but the Taylor series expansion for e to the lambda 1 t, and then this is e to the lambda nt, and then you all have these diagonal entries. Therefore, once you take, for example, once you compute such a thing, an exponential, okay, so if you have especially large matrices, rather than computing this at every time step, okay, it is much easier to compute this every time step. First, make the diagonalization out of loop, for example, if you are making a numerical calculation, outside the loop, diagonalize your, for example, A matrix, okay, in, for example, MATLAB today, it's easy. If you just say diagonal, for example, of a matrix, it's going to give you, generate your eigenvalues and eigenvectors immediately if this is a diagonalizable matrix, of course. And then you, outside your loop, you find lambda 1, lambda 2, and lambda n terms, okay? Therefore, at every time step, when you do time step inside a loop, for example, so when you specify a different t number, don't compute this every time step, but just compute this one. This is a constant matrix. This is a constant matrix. And then you will only have a single value in here. So the generation of this is going to be very, for example, easy. So in MATLAB, if you, for example, write a code in MATLAB, you can write a statement like, you know, tic-tac. So any of you has heard this before, the tic-tac in the MATLAB, or after, for example, record the computation time. So when you, for example, so let me stop the share. I will come back. Okay. So I'm sure that different compilers have different, for example, options and different commands, but I'm much familiar with MATLAB. I'm using MATLAB. So let me share my screen. And for example, if you have, for example, a MATLAB code in which you start like, for example, sorry, like clear all, close all, you generally start like this if you want to kill all parameters. So you have all parameters, etc. inside your MATLAB code. And then if you say, for example, tick, okay, sorry. My hand touched the corner of the screen, so the OneNote is closed. Excuse me, I need to reopen this. So, for example, if you write somewhere tick, okay, And then if you do some computations, for example, if you have a time loop, for example, or say time is equal to starting from zero and up to, for example, 0.01 to maybe 1000, okay, and you have some operations, okay, and then if you said, for example, if you can just write tak, or you can just say that you can define a parameter, the first time parameter is equal to tak, okay, so it's going to give you the for example, the amount of computation time, okay, spent there. Okay. Therefore, if you want to measure time, for example, in a MATLAB compiler, you can use this, for example, tick-tock comments. So you can say that, well, such a case, I can write a very, for example, a simple code to check, for example, what is the computation time of this thing. If you have a huge matrix, define a huge matrix, and then do this every time step, or rather than doing this at every time step, just do this operation. So what is the benefit in the computation time? You can write a code for yourself, like, you know, a couple of maybe lines, involving a couple of lines, okay? Any questions until here? So let me talk about this part, because I have frame alternative and not so many things, and then I will complete the discussion, and in the second hour I will start discussing the vector calculus. So we can say that if we have a non-homogeneous equation like this, okay, so remember our regular eigenvalue problem is equal to ax is equal to lambda x, but what if we have an additional, for example, constant vector like this, okay, c. Well, such an equation is going to be a non-homogeneous equation, okay? So you have some operator, for example, lambda x is equal to not zero, but lambda x is equal to, for example, c, a constant. If you think this as a, for example, a differential, for example, equation, if you merge a and lambda operations, for example, then what you obtain is basically an operator operating on x is equal to not zero, but a constant. So you have something like a source term in your equation, okay? Therefore, this becomes a non-homogeneous equation. So you can use the methods of diagonalization for the solutions of the non-homogeneous equations as well. And then you can check the chapter 11.3.2. So if again is A is n by n, and if lambda and C are basically are known, so you know the A and lambda and C. So you can say that it is a non-homogeneous equation, but one solution technique is basically something called the eigenvector expansion method, okay? Therefore, first what you do is basically you find the eigenvalues and eigenvectors for your solution, and then you express your arbitrary solution in terms of this, for example, this eigenvalues and eigenvectors, and then you plug this into your solution, okay, into your equation involving C. Therefore, you draw some equations for C. So I'm sure you have seen this before. For example, when you have an equation like this, for example, x double prime, okay, plus, for example, x is equal to zero. Okay, so let me stop the sharing here. So I will come back to this point again, but share the one note screen. So in math, I need to do this. So for example, if you have a differential equation like this, x double square, for example, say k square x and is equal to zero, okay, x is a function of time, okay. So, well, you know that the solutions, this is a homogeneous equation, you know that the solutions are going to be in terms of sines and cosines, okay. Sines and cosines. But well, what if, for example, if you have a source term, okay? So if you have, for example, an equation like this, k square x, maybe a polynomial, for example, on the right-hand side, at square plus, for example, bt plus c. Then what you are going to do? Well, first, you will say that the sine solution and cosine solution is there from the homogeneous part, okay? But you will also have a particular part, okay? And in order to deal with this particular part, well, you can seek a solution, for example, in terms of polynomials. Why? Because on the right hand side you have a polynomial, and if you say that, well, I seek a solution maybe in terms of, for example, So let me talk about this part because I have framework alternative and not so many of things, and then I will complete the discussion, and in the second hour I will start discussing the vector calculus. So we can say that if we have a non-homogeneous equation like this, okay, so remember our regular eigenvalue problem is equal to Ax is equal to lambda x. But what if we have an additional, for example, constant vector like this, okay, c. Well, such an equation is going to be a non-homogeneous equation, okay? So you have some operator, for example, lambda x is equal to not zero, but lambda x is equal to, for example, c, a constant. If you think this as a, for example, a differential, for example, equation, if you merge a and lambda operations, for example, then what you obtain is basically an operator operating on x is equal to not zero, but a constant. So you have something like a source term in your equation, okay? Therefore, this becomes a non-homogeneous equation. So you can use the methods of diagonalization for the solutions of the non-homogeneous equations as well. And then you can check the chapter 11.3.2. So if again is A is n by n, and if lambda and C are basically are known, so you know the A and lambda and C. So you can say that it is a non-homogeneous equation, but one solution technique is basically something called the eigenvector expansion method, okay? Therefore, first what you do is basically you find the eigenvalues and eigenvectors for your solution, and then you express your arbitrary solution in terms of this, for example, this eigenvalues and eigenvectors, and then you plug this into your solution, okay, into your equation involving C. Therefore, you draw some equations for C. So I'm sure you have seen this before. For example, when you have an equation like this, for example, x double prime, okay, plus, for example, x is equal to zero. Okay, so let me stop the sharing here. So I will come back to this point again, but share the one note screen. So in math, I need to do this. So for example, if you have a differential equation like this, x double square, for example, say k square x and is equal to zero, okay, x is a function of time, okay. So, well, you know that the solutions, this is a homogeneous equation, you know that the solutions are going to be in terms of sines and cosines, okay. Sines and cosines. But, well, what if, for example, if you have a source term, okay, so if you have, for example, an equation like this, k square x, maybe a polynomial, for example, on the right-hand side, at square plus, for example, bt plus c, then what you are going to do? Well, first, you will say that the sine solution and cosine solution is there from the homogeneous part, okay? But you will also have a particular part, okay? And in order to deal with this particular part, well, you can seek a solution, for example, in terms of polynomials. Why? Because on the right-hand side, you have a polynomial. And if you say that, well, I seek a solution maybe in terms of, for example, polynomials, say, like, you know, at squared plus bt plus ct or c. If you plug this in and plug this in inside your governing equations, then you will get, for example, a relation between the capital ABC and the small ABC on the right-hand side, okay? Therefore, you will be able to get, for example, solution. Therefore, what you do is generally, basically, when you have a non-homogeneous equation, so you not only have the homogeneous part, but you also have the particular part to obtain the general solution. The general solution is basically a summation of these two things in here. Okay, and then it's logical to seek a solution in terms of the particular, for example, forcing function. Okay, so in the dynamics course, you have seen this before, for example, when you introduce the concept of the forcing. So if you have sine and cosine, for example, function on the left hand side, okay, so you have again an equation like this, but say that on the right hand side, you have a specific forcing like f0, say cosine omega zero t, okay? Well, if you periodically force your, for example, equation, Then what you are going to see is basically you will see a non-homogeneous part first of all, again in terms of sine and cosines, sine kt, cosine kt for example. And additionally, what you are going to see, so it's going to be the homogeneous part. From the particular part, again, you will say that, well, let's seek a solution like this. Let's seek a solution like a sine omega 0 t plus b cosine omega 0 t. So what you are doing is basically, well, you have, for example, let me erase this part and write this in more detail. So this can be confusing. So you know that the solution in here, the homogeneous part is going to tell you that, well, if the right hand side is equal to zero, so you will have a, for example, cosine kt, okay, plus b sine kt, okay. So you know that this is the case. But well, this is only homogeneous part. So for the particular part, what you are going to do is basically you are going to seek a solution in terms of this, for example, form of the right hand side. So you seek a solution in terms of omega zero and omega zero. Therefore, you take this inside your governing equation and then evaluate this equation and then equate the left hand side with the right hand side. Therefore, you find the relation between, for example, A and B. Okay. Therefore, well, once you solve, for example, such an equation, therefore, in the denominator, for example, when you write the general solution, if you don't have any, for example, dissipation, you will have some terms in here, and then you will obtain terms like including k minus omega zero in the denominator. Okay, so this is going to introduce you the concept of the resonance. If these two frequencies are basically identical to each other, your system is resonating. So it tells you that, well, the natural, for example, oscillation frequency of your system k is basically equal to the frequency of the forcing. Okay, therefore you will see a zero term on the denominator, and then you will see that your solution is basically blowing up. Okay, it goes to infinity. So if you forget this kind of stuff, please try to remind yourself. So we will see this from time to time about the homogeneous and the particular solutions. So well, let's take a couple of more minutes if you want. Then you can say that, well, first you solve the homogeneous equation, you find the lambdas and e's, you find an orthogonal basis, okay? But in order to deal with this, for example, constant in here, what you are going to do is basically, you will say that, you will assume that, or you will seek a solution in terms of this basis function. So you will say that my solution is basically a linear combination of these basis functions, okay? In terms of Fourier series, these are basically sines and cosines. So you take this expression and put it over your governing equation. So if you put it over your governing equation, what you are going to see is basically such a form, okay? So you will have this stuff and then you will have that stuff. And similarly, on the right-hand side, you will have summation of, for example, C vectors in terms of CJs and EJs, okay? So it's going to be expressed like this. But you can say that, well, you can find out this, for example, CJ constants, for example, individually. So remember, if you have, for example, your C vector is equal to this thing here, and if you take the dot product of this vector with EJ, so what you are going to see? Well, this is, remember, this is equal to C. And then if you take the dot product of C with EJ, therefore, once you compute this numerator, so what you are going to see, this thing is equal to C. You take the dot product with EJ from the left and the right hand side, and EJ dot EJ is going to survive, but all other EJs, for example, when J and I are not identical to each other, they are going to die out because these are orthogonal vectors, okay? Therefore, you will see that E1 times E1 is going to survive, but E1 times E2, E1 times E3, E1 times E4, all of them are going to die out. Therefore, you will be able to find out by using a simple dot product, you will be able to find out this, for example, component easily, okay? This constants easily, okay? So, well, you can say that once you, for example, write this, for example, equation in this form, okay? So, you can basically, well, put the lambdas over here, okay? And put the AJs over here, and then on the right-hand side, you have this, for example, expression. Therefore, you can say that, well, for example, like in the case of cosine and sine, There are no, for example, dependence of EJ to the EI. Okay, all EJs are linearly independent. Therefore, well, in order to have such an equality, I should say that, well, this constant in here is supposed to be equal to that constant here. Okay, so therefore, you can solve an equation, a non-homogeneous equation, using this, for example, algebraic equation. So you reduce your equation to an algebraic case for this one. For example, if you say that, well, if lambda j's, all of them are basically non-zero. So if you have non-zero, for example, lambda j values, okay, then what you are going to see is basically, well, if this is non-zero, then you can basically make this simple division, and it's going to give you the constant in here, and then you go back and put it to your expression. Remember, we have expanded x vector in terms of a j and ej, therefore you obtain a unique solution. Okay, so if you suppose that, well, one or more of the, for example, lambdas happen to coincide with, for example, the capital lambda, therefore if you say, for example, only two of them are equal to the same lambda and all our remaining lambda j's are basically different. So, for example, for this C1 and C2 case, okay, so you obtain no solution and because the denominator is going to blow up, okay, when for this case. But if C1 and C2, for example, both of these ones are basically equal to zero, therefore, you will have all bunch of solutions, okay, depending on your nature. And this all bunch of solutions can be expressed like this, okay. So you have unique solution for the eigenvalues involving lambda 3, lambda 4, lambda 5, etc. So this part is unique. But if you have this such a thing, and if these are non-zero, basically you have no solution. But if these are zero, therefore, you have no unique solution, possible solution of two different vectors, okay. So this is an example of something called the Fredholm alternative, okay? And you see in the mathematics. And then remember, you can also use the Gaussian elimination and other techniques to solve this kind of number.